position and with your background and experience continuing on. We all look forward to working with you all, not only Janet and I, but the other committee members are going to show up here shortly, I suspect. We hope. And then for the purpose of those that are here, we will hear one bill, which was referred here, Senate Bill 539, which happens to be one of my bills on child care, and which we hopefully can deal with fairly quickly when we have a quorum. So Janet, do you have anything, any questions, comments at this time? Okay. All right, that being the case, Dr. Carey, we look forward to hearing from you.
Sure. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. I've got some slides and we can share those with you, and I may refer to the very last slide. Mr. Tweed and I have kind of touched base at the end, but we'll get to that. I guess in our time together, I thought it would be most useful just to introduce myself a bit as to my own experience and what brought me to this position and what I may bring to the table. Talk about three priorities for the governor in this area, and then finish up, if that's all right, and introduce the new members of the staff. So thank you very much. First of all, I have been a cardiologist for about 30 years, and I think there's a little bit of a once a cardiologist, always a cardiologist. I was educated, I come from an Air Force family and grew up around the United States, mostly in Virginia, North Carolina, and Florida. I went to high school down in Hampton, Virginia, when my dad was stationed at Langley, and then went to the University of Virginia to undergraduate school and did my medical school training up in Boston at Harvard, and then internal medicine in San Francisco and cardiology at Emory, and then served in the Air Force for 4 years. And then at that point, joined private practice in Lynchburg, Virginia for the last 21 years. And there I had roles in the cardiac cath lab and being the medical director of a heart center. And then I think pertinent to this group is that 5 years ago, I made a decision to leave full-time medical practice and become an executive with the health system there, Centrum. So I had a year and a half as the president of two to now almost 400 member medical group, and then became the chief medical officer. And the reason I mention that is that I have a passion for clinical medicine. I love being a physician. I love being a physician now, and up until last Friday, still saw patients occasionally in the clinic and helped out on call. But I also think in my role at Centra, with supporting performance improvement, supporting the medical staff, performing the new clinical integrated network, and overseeing the quality and safety of the health system, I learned to appreciate the value of data, the value of analytics, and the importance of robust process improvement to improve large systems. And I realize a billion-dollar health system is not the state of Virginia, but it does have some scale, and it required understanding that data and moving large groups of people in one direction. So I really appreciate the opportunity to come and serve the governor, serve the citizens of the Commonwealth in this new role. I realize I have a lot to learn, and I have to learn it well, and I have to learn it fast. And we've got some great members of the agencies that I support here that they deserve a leader that learns fast and learns well, and I will try to be the leader they deserve as well. One of the things before moving on is that I learned is that medicine at one point, and frankly, I think social work and behavioral health work and the other areas of our secretariat may have been more solitary endeavors. Now we realize that it takes a team, and sometimes it takes a team of teams to integrate the goals, integrate the resources in novel and creative ways to be successful. And I think it's never been more true today, and I think it's never been more true when we think of the roles that the different agencies play in social services, behavioral health, development of services, intellectual disabilities, public health goals. They are so tightly integrated that it really takes a team, and it takes us working as a highly functioning team. So I'd like to talk about three goals in the governor's agenda. It's funny, I wasn't sure the chemistry in the room, but why don't we go with the slide. But you can see there are experts in the room that have actually developed the programs that I'm going to mention. So I'm a little self-conscious of that because I'm really standing on the shoulders of incredibly able people from the previous administration, many of whom remain in public service. So it's I'm very humble presenting this information. But what you can see in this slide is that there's a dramatic increase in the number of deaths from opioid overdose, both from prescription overdose prescriptions as well as from the illicit opioids. Next slide. All right. Do I have that?
I'm getting it for
you. I'll take it. And we really, there has been a team approach, and the keys are both prevention and treatment. I'd like to highlight something that I'm highlighting because I think it deserves to be expanded. And that would be the ARTS program. I think Kate Neuhauser's here, and one of the architects of this program, along with many others. So the ARTS program, Addiction Recovery and Treatment Services, I highlight because it is a novel approach with patients in the Medicaid world that are getting the full spectrum of services in a novel way. And the reason I highlight it is that it's even in the first 5 months, and we have other outcomes that we'll be sharing once it's adjudicated by the VCU, which is the center that's providing the data analysis, that a 50% increase in treatment rates for patients that were newly eligible for the program, and a dramatic increase in the number of practitioners. You see 300 to over almost 700 providers, and a similar rise in those for substance use disorder. So if you design a program that the team has designed, it's based on best practices, American Society for Addiction Medicine, and then you educate the provider community about it, there's a significant response. And what we see is dramatic increase in access to the different patient groups within those that have opioid addiction. So that's the second item I wanted to highlight, and this there are folks from DBHDS here, and Jack Barber and the team have put forth a strategic plan for behavioral health services and focusing on improving or decreasing the variability from one consumer community service board to another. And I'm focusing here on it's not a pilot program, but with this, the General Assembly has funded is 18 of the 40 community service boards focusing on same-day access, one of the first elements of STEP Virginia. And those are the highlighted there, the areas that are part of this program in 2017. And one of those outcomes, what we've seen is a dramatic decrease in the wait time, which was, of course, the primary goal. We've seen a significant decrease in the no-shows, and we've also eliminated the waiting list. And behavioral health, it's key to get people into treatment rapidly. If they're not, they either escalate and they require hospitalization, or they don't turn to follow-up and you have increased long-term hospitalizations, not just emergency room visits and the like. So this is a initial phase of the STEP Virginia services, same-day access, and there's a timeline for implementing funding and implementing these other aspects, but this first step shows incredible promise. And the reason I mention these two programs is that how could we make them even better? We could actually fund them to their full extent. And that's the third priority that I'd like to mention today, namely expansion of Medicaid in Virginia. That would allow us to care for the hundreds of thousands of patients in that group, up to 138% of the federal poverty level, that are not getting the services they need. So if you care about behavioral health, if you care about the opioid addiction problem, that the resources that come with Medicaid expansion dramatically improve access to services and the services that can be provided. So, as I kind of close my time, I just wanted to emphasize that as I approach my work, working with the agencies, working with the team at HHR, I want to bring what I've learned working in a health system, and that is the importance of high reliability and the focus on safety and quality. That's already present That's not new to the different areas, but it's certainly an area of focus of mine. And I think that one of the ways to improve the bang for the buck that Virginia invests in these services is to identify those low-value services and minimize them and look to high-value services like the work that's being done in SIP Virginia in this first step. Look at the program with addiction services as well, and expand and improve their impact. I realize that it's difficult to train for this position. I'm very humbled that the governor would select me for this. I realize it is an entirely new ball game, and I've got a lot to learn, and I've got a lot to learn from this group. And I just want to let you know that I'm open to your feedback as time goes on. I want to work with this group, and I will do my best both to serve the Commonwealth, serve the governor, and also support the great teams we have at the agencies within HHR. So the one thing I want to go over before we finish, we have two important people here. I'll go from left to right. Gina Boyle-Berger is one of our deputies, and I'm thrilled to have her on our team. And Marvin Figueroa is the other deputy, and I'm the newest to public service. They have extensive experience with Mark Warner's staff and health policy, as well as with Gina with the Kane administration and the policy shop. So there are their specific areas of responsibility in terms of the agencies they support. And we'll do our best to provide support for the agencies and also be a conduit to other areas of the government. So with that, if there are any questions, Mr. Chairman, I'm happy to entertain those.
Okay. Well, thank you, Mr. Secretary. Well, I'd certainly like Gina and Marvin's phone number right away. So we got some quick decisions to make over the next couple of weeks.
Okay, well, yeah. I will get those for you. I have them memorized in my contact list, but I haven't memorized them myself.
Great,
we'll make
great.
Sure we'll make sure we get those to you.
Great, thank you.
Good.
Or email if you'd rather communicate late at night.
Whatever you prefer, Mr.
The any of the members have a question, Dr. Carey? Dr. Carey, we certainly appreciate you being here today and your attitude about working cooperatively. We're going to try to do that. We've got a lot to take care of in the short run that being the session.
Sure.
And hopefully we'll keep everything on the table during the session, and then we can work a lot together in the interim.
Look forward to it. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I appreciate that. The observe Senator Stewart is part of this committee now. Good to have you here with us.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Sorry I was late.
Yeah, he's a quick study. He's got a lot to learn, and it's taking me a while, but we'll be a great addition. Thank you. The next, we're going to move on to Department of Social Services. Duke Stewart, the Commissioner of Department of Social Services. Duke, good to have you with us here today.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you. It's great to be here.
And look forward to working with you and your staff.
Well, good afternoon, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, Mr. Tweedy. Really pleased with the opportunity to present our budget to you today. Before we get started, I just offer a couple notes of my background, since we'll be working closely together. 16 years ago, I was here in Richmond working at the Department of Social Services and the Division of Benefit Programs. Stayed there about 4 years, left and went to a small nonprofit IT consulting firm working with states and the federal government on child welfare systems and child support systems. Did what I swore I would never do and became a Fed and worked for the U.S. Department of Agriculture at the Food Nutrition Services, helping manage all the nation's federal nutrition programs, and then spent the last 5 years at an organization called Share Our Strength running the No Kid Hungry campaign. We had a very active campaign and still do here in Virginia to end childhood hunger, and it's just an honor to be here, an honor to serve with you and your colleagues and our members of the legislature. So,
I know it'll be a big transition for you. We're used to Margaret, of course, she was ready for for a vacation, I think, if she.
I think a well-deserved one. I was, of course, I knew Margaret for years, and when I was talking to her, sort of in between, she said that this is the first time in 21 years Margaret Schultz wasn't in some capacity in the governor's office.
Something
so,
like that, yeah.
But I'm in great hands.
It was commissioner when you were here.
Maurice Jones and Anthony
yeah.
Conyers,
yep.
So we had a combination of those two.
Okay, great.
Great leaders.
Well, good to have you back.
Well, thank you very much. So, you know, the presentation today is organized into four parts. I'm going to provide some context to the governor's budget and legislative proposals. I'll start with a brief overview of the department, followed by some background on the budget, proceed to the governor's budget proposals, and then close with a couple salient updates that I think you'll be interested in. In Virginia, we consider it to be a social services system, not just a social services department. We work in a state-supervised but locally administered business model for the vast majority of our services. There are 120 local departments of social services. They have approximately 9,000 employees, and they really distinguish themselves each day for providing high-quality services despite, you know, increasing workloads. We have two significant programs that are directly administered by the state, our Child Support Enforcement Program, long considered a national leader in both collections and innovation and support for non-custodial parents, and our licensing division, which inspects licenses and works with over 7,000 adult and child facilities. Most of our social services system spending occurs outside of the DSS appropriation from the General Assembly. The statewide economic impact from the department's funding and its programs exceeds $12 billion annually. These are FY17 figures, and you can see that Medicaid is the largest of all those benefit programs, including dollars. Local staff and operations, while it might look like a big number, $600 million, really, that's the gateway to our $12 billion. You know, that is how the benefits that come from the federal programs and the appropriation of our services and benefits at the state level, they all flow through those local staff and operations. And so, you know, that's about a 5% of the total. So the DSS budget has multiple funding sources, including state, federal, special, and local funds. The local funds are not appropriated at the state level, but you can see they contribute significantly to the service delivery as matching funds to access our federal grants and funds. Federal funds are a major component of the social services system financing. They contribute more than a third of the total department funding. They're spread over a host of 36 or so federal grant programs. There's a high degree of regulation around each of these 36 grant programs, and it accounts for significant budget complexity and not as much flexibility as we would all want. In looking at the general fund expenditures of the department, a couple highlights. First, three items: local department operations, child welfare services, and self-sufficiency programs. They're the big drivers. They compose 73% of all general fund expenditures of the department. I'd like to sort of point out there, when we're looking at the administration and support line, which is $51 million. 40% of that are payments to VITA for their goods and services. Second, the most general fund growth in recent years has been associated with child welfare services, particularly adoption, subsidies, and foster care. And finally, you know, we continue to see that VITA line, you know, really be necessary for us to achieve the service infrastructure that makes these programs run. You know, we've recently got off of a major sort of old legacy system over the last few years. for many of our benefit programs, and we're just embarking on a similar process for child welfare. So when we talk through the budget amendments, most of these affect DSS programs, with one impacting my colleagues at the Department of Health, which is funded by TANF, which I'll mention briefly. So they're in a number of buckets: child welfare services, TANF and self-sufficiency, child support, a couple of technology budget actions, local staff operations, adult services, and administrative. You can see here the budget amendment totals over in FY18 and then over the next biennium. So talking a little bit about the child welfare services. So each year, the Department of Planning and Budget provides a forecast on our child welfare services, predominantly foster care and adoption subsidy payments. The funding adjustments here are based on that forecast, are indicated. Increases in this forecast are primarily being driven by foster care caseload increases due to substance abuse. So to underscore the Secretary's importance of the opioid epidemic and other substance abuse problems, that has a downstream impact on all sorts of services, including foster care. So interesting, one provision of the Fostering Connections to Success and Increasing Adoptions Act of 2008 is that the primary funding source, Title IV-E, gradually is assuming financial responsibilities of the state's federal match, which is 50% for Virginia, for all of adoption assistance and maintenance payments. So this change has shifted financial responsibility for a number of adoption subsidy cases from 100% state funds to 50% federally funded maintenance. But the federal law requires states to reinvest that savings in general fund to support post-adoption support services and other child welfare services. So without the 4E revenue realized under this provision, the general fund share of the mandated adoption subsidies would be dollar for dollar. I guess what I'm trying to say is, this action is not costing the state general funds any dollars it would not have already been required to expend. So a change at the federal level is saving us money in payments, but we're required to reinvest those. So the general fund number stays the same. We're getting more federal dollars put into the system, and we're able to provide a greater breadth of services. Talking a little bit about TANF and the self-sufficiency budget actions. So first of all, TANF. So based on DPB's forecasts, the appropriation for TANF benefits drops to $65.7 million in 19 and further declines in 20 to $61 million. The decrease in the cost of mandatory benefits and services provides the opportunity to use these TANF funds for other critical needs. And we're proposing $6 million in TANF funding to be allocated to the Department of Health for long-acting reversible contraceptive program, often referred to as LARC. LARC meets the purpose three of TANF, which is to prevent and reduce the incidence of out-of-wedlock births. And we have further information on LARC can be provided by my esteemed colleague from the Department of Health who's here today. The forecast also includes a small increase for the unemployed parent program. This is the public assistance benefits that go to two parent families, and we manage those payments out of the general fund to help us with work requirements at the federal level. I can answer more questions about that if you're interested. So there's a couple other amendments around self-sufficiency supports. You know, the first is the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Employment Training Program. So we had received a federal grant to test innovative models of delivering employment and training services, and this change reflects the sunset of that grant. Moving on to child support enforcement. So this amendment offsets the decline in the Division of Child Support Enforcement collections of TANF cases. Child support actions are critical to the well-being of Virginia's children. Many of those children are from low-income families who otherwise would have not received child support payments from their non-custodial parents. These funds are needed to maintain current service levels at the Division of Child Support, because when we retain TANF collections, because the TANF retained collections are not sufficient to cover the division's portion of the operating expenditures. So TANF collections are a major funding source for the Child Support Enforcement Program. The state share of TANF collections is used as a match to attain federal child support funds. So when we retain those TANF dollars, we keep a percentage of those, and that allows us to pull down from the federal government child support dollars. When we see the TANF caseload coming down and TANF child support collections being reduced because of a smaller caseload, it inhibits our ability to have that available match dollars to pull down the child support enforcement funds from the federal government. So that's really the genesis of needing this amendment. So governor's proposed budget technology actions. This restoration of VITA funding is really a technical correction that comes out of a mistake made somewhere along the way before I got here, and I couldn't speak to it if I had to. But all I know is it's a technical amendment to an appropriation from previous years that's helped us restore that funding and enabled us to really focus on our important technology investments that are critical support to delivering our services. And then we see the Division of Licensing, a modest appropriation for non-general funds to use to support the upgrade and maintenance of our licensing system. So as we talked about before, the local departments of social services are the gateway to the administration of our programs. That's the annual budget line of about $600 million. So this request and appropriation is to be able to allow us to spend non-general funds to support that local infrastructure, things like local retiree health insurance, modest salary increases, the technology investments that we need to have to keep our systems running effectively and efficiently, et cetera. Auxiliary grants are an important adult service, and this budget amendment masks something really great that's happening with our auxiliary grant program. We intend to increase that grant by $35 on July 1st. We're gonna couple that increase with a $15 increase from SSI that goes into effect, went into effect January 1st. So the amount of the auxiliary grant paid will increase about $50, just about a 4% increase. So that rate increase will cost the program about $1.4 million. However, because we've accrued savings over time, we are still realizing a general fund savings in this line, despite that rate increase. And then the next line is an assisted living facility for those with serious mental illness. Funds increased AG costs due to the development of a 25-bed facility. The majority of those costs are with the Department of Behavioral Health and Disability Services, But this reflects our share of those ongoing expenses.
Mr. Chair.
Which question?
Senator Barker?
Yes. On the auxiliary grant program, you talked about having accrued monies in some way. Is that because you had appropriations and you didn't have the facilities participating to be able to use all those, and so therefore those have been carried over?
Sure. I'm going to take my first stab at answering that, and then my colleagues can jump in if I don't get it wrong. I think accrued was probably the wrong word. I think we have underspend in the appropriation, and when we project participation, the auxiliary grants, while we are increasing the rate, it's still a very small amount of money relative to the total cost of those placements. And so the uptake of auxiliary grants is not as high as the available budget. And so this was a way to reprogram underspend to get more participation in the program. I don't know if anybody wants to add to that.
J.R. Simpson, Chief Deputy, Mr. Chairman, Senator Barker. I heard you answer the question in the committee meeting the other day. You hit the nail right on the head. It's essentially we have providers that are unable to take the rates that we pay. And I think it's somewhere we pay about a third to 40% of what the total cost is. So part of the reason that we're running surplus is that for the 12 years I've been in the department, we've been given auxiliary grant money back almost every year for the very same reason.
Just to follow up, Mr. Chair, I think the figure we have when we look at it through the Joint Commission on Healthcare this year is the auxiliary grant payment level is about 29% of what the actual costs are. So needless to say, there are not a lot of facilities looking to participate and lose 71 cents on the dollar in every situation. And so the number of people who, there are a lot of people who would qualify if they could get in, but they just can't get into the facility. So I think that's, $50 will help a little bit, but we've got a long ways to go.
Right, sure.
Much utilization of that.
Thank you.
And now, Senator Barker, now that you raised the issue, I think that's probably something we need to look at, because it appears to me over time we've allowed, because of the low auxiliary grant, we've allowed some of the people that have been previously served or would have been served in those types of facilities quite adequately to have to seek placement in much more expensive environments that we're putting the bill for.
Yes.
It's something for us to look at. It goes back to when we made it more stringent, the licensing more stringent, put a lot of requirements, new requirements in place. And that was almost back when you were there, I believe.
Right.
It's been a while.
Mr. Chairman, it's been getting worse, but it's been a problem for at least 30 years.
Right.
Sure.
But I was on the board. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. All right.
Well, we look forward to working with you on finding a solution.
Okay.
Thank you. Great. So moving on to a few more proposed budget actions. We're proposing to establish an Office of Immigration Assistance at the Department of Social Services to assist persons who are lawfully entering the United States and Virginia for the purpose of becoming citizens. We're also looking to increase rent and lease charges for our regional, the rent and lease charges for our regional offices, which provide support and oversight, training, technical assistance to our local departments of social services. Many of them have been in their current office space for 10 years or more, and as those leases are coming up, there's an increased cost, and this just reflects some of that housekeeping that we need to do to keep those open. I will say that we have been pretty diligent as a department to look at ways that we can mitigate those costs through closing down offices, employing technology more efficiently, et cetera. So this small number, I think, reflects some good work already done in that area. And then finally, we're gonna remove some one-time funding from legislation HB 2092. It passed in 2017 session. It was included in our appropriation. The bill required the review of additional records to determine eligibility for public assistance. However, the legislation was ultimately vetoed by the governor, but the appropriation remained in our budget. So this action just removes that funding. And the final is Medicaid expansion, which the critical importance of was referenced by the secretary. This really reflects additional resources necessary for our local departments of social services to handle that increased volume of applications that would come with Medicaid expansion. Probably about, current estimates are around 220,000 increased applications in 19, and that ramps up to about 355 applications in 2020. So this is to support for that increased workload at our local departments of social services.
There's 1,000.
What's that?
You left out the 1,000.
Oh, sorry.
330.
Yes, 355,000. Thank you. I'm going to end with a couple program updates. The first is looking at our TANF budgets. The 2017 Consolidated Appropriation Act provides that about 1/3 of 1% of our state's TANF allotment be made available for research, technical assistance, and evaluation for FY17 and 18. This reduces our grant by $522,000. So in case you're kind of keeping track from previous years and wondering why it's a little lower, that's the reason for it. It's unclear at this point whether that reduction will be continued past federal fiscal year 18. Also want to note that the president's proposed budget calls for a 10% reduction in the TANF block grant. That would equate to just under $16 million should that come to pass. So just a little flag as we keep an eye on what's happening in Washington. Really the greatest changes in the TANF budget for the 2018 session are the reduction in cash assistance and the VUE child care service appropriations. As we see the caseloads falling in the program, we're paying out less in cash, and then we're paying out less in those support services like child care, employment services, etc. And so we see that as a reduced expenditure, and we're projecting those TANF caseloads to continue to go down, and that's why we see that continued reduction in proposed expenditures. And again, just the one note about the proposal for the TANF grant balances. Again, this is an accrual over time of underspending in the TANF block grant. And so we're proposing $6 million to go to the Department of Health for March. I want to talk a little bit about a couple key performance metrics in the Medicaid program and where we are, because it's been quite a journey. This slide shows you our monthly Medicaid applications received of and disposed. And you can see that there was a big spike there in the blue when ACA came on board, and that we are continuing to really have a significant increase in the number of applications that we dispose of each month. Some of those are coming from the federal facilitated marketplace applications, in addition to our traditional applications running that we've had for families and children and ABD and others. Most of those federal marketplace applications are handled through a central processing unit that DMAS has stood up called Cover VA. So, in November 2017, Medicaid enrollees were up 4.5% from the year previous, about 1.1 million more enrollees. CHIP enrollees are up 13.5%. from November of 2017, a total number of 69,000 more enrollees. And then just as we had an important note about the TANF funding and the federal budget, you know, we do have significant concerns about CHIP, which has not been reauthorized at the federal level, and we are only expected to be able to run CHIP for this quarter before we run out of funds to support the program. So another really important implication.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Just the spike, the big spike you talked about there in early 2014, if my recollection is correct, I think that was driven to a large extent by a large number of applications coming from Northern Virginia that speculation was related to the fact that D.C. and Maryland were implementing their plans, and people thought that we had the same approach here in Virginia. Is that correct on that?
Actually, Senator Barker, I don't know the answer to that.
I think it's accurate. In fact, it was pretty widespread all over Virginia because it appears, you know, that there was going to be eligibility, and we, of course, were debating it during that period of time and didn't do it, but you still had to.
Came close.
Yeah, it came close, right.
That's right. Still have to process those applications,
yeah,
whether they're good or not.
Right.
Sir.
Thank you.
And then finally, I'd like to touch on our overdue Medicaid renewals. We had a significant challenge on overdue renewals, and I think the important point of this slide is that we've worked hard to solve that problem. We're not quite back down to zero, but it's been significant progress with a lot of work over a short period of time. And so I think we're back on track with our overdue renewals and doing a really good job. So I'm gonna stop there and see if there's any more questions or comments for education.
All right, any of the members have additional questions for the commissioner? Okay, well, we certainly appreciate the presentation. I think while you're still here, we're gonna take up one bill. We have one bill on the docket which pertains to your shop. And that is a bill, it's actually my bill, Senate Bill 539, which was reported to us from Rehabilitation and Social Services.
Mr. Chairman, behind tab 4 is the summary and the actual bill, if you want to see
it. It's actually in the tabs?
Yep, it's in there. Yep.
Okay, good. All right, I'll draw the members' attention to tab 4. There are a number of requirements. This bill would be familiar to most of the members of this committee because it's essentially in the same format as it was last year. There were a couple of adjustments to it, but it deals with child day programs, exemptions from licensure. It clarifies certain programs that are completely exempt from licensure that are actually programs that are not even considered child daycare. It also clarifies more clearly programs that are exempt from licensure, but it requires these programs that are exempt from licensure to comply with certain items as far as disclosure to the public and a detailed list that's included with the bill. The reason that it referred to us after it came from rehab was potential fiscal impact. And I would call your attention to the fact that there may be, now this is where we're going to push on you a little bit, maybe,
sure.
But if this were to pass, there are requirements for you to stand this program up, but there's also a provision in there which if you determine that you can't do it from existing appropriations or the existing federal monies from child block grants that are there, then you would prepare numbers and it would not be implemented until we actually fund it if there are additional funds that are needed. This came about as over a long process that the previous commissioner worked on with stakeholders, and it has broad support. It got crossways in the road last year when some of the members over there wanted to accomplish some other purposes that really weren't germane to what we were intending to do here. So that's the bill. The members of the committee comfortable with your understanding of what the bill is supposed to do? If you are, Chair would entertain a motion that we we recommend to the full committee for tomorrow's agenda that it be reported.
Second.
Motion properly supported, that's Senate Bill 539, be recommended to be reported at the full committee meeting tomorrow morning. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, we will recommend that it be reported tomorrow morning. All right. Does that conclude your presentation? Look forward to working with you on this and a lot of other items. I did have one question, which would be unfair to put the question directly to you. Maybe someone of your staff here is familiar with it, but under the child support enforcement, oh, it's always been curious to me the numbers, the amazing numbers that are children that are cases in child support enforcement. Do you know where that number's at now in terms of the number? Is it range over?
In the 300,000 range, I believe.
Is that, if it's in the 300,000 range, that's an improvement of where it used to be.
It could be higher. I don't have my statistical report, but we can get that
okay.
very easily.
But it is moving, it has been moving down.
I think that's a good thing, unless there's some other reason.
Related tenant case.
Is that okay? Okay. All right, well, thank you. We'll follow up on that. Thank you very
thank
much.
You, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. All right, then we'll move on to with our health commissioner, who's not a new person. She's been working with us for a number of years now, Marissa. And you have a big job as well, so we thank you for taking time to be with us.
Mr. Chairman. Could I just apologize to the doctor in advance that George and I are going to have to walk out on you? I'm sorry.
Okay. I won't take it personally.
Yeah, don't. Okay. We'll read up.
Okay. Got a lot of conflicts with
if
the
If you have questions, reach out to me. Mr. Chair, members of the subcommittee who are staying, it's always a pleasure to be with you. I'm glad to be back this year. And I know you're pressed for time, so I'll try to work through this pretty quickly. I did want to say thank you for the opportunity to get to speak with you on behalf of over 3,600 people who make up DDH around the state. We do look forward to working with you through the session on their behalf and on behalf of everybody in Virginia. I'm going to go through a few overview and updates from DDH, talk about Virginia's health status, which I think is important for you to hear, and then how we and many others have been implementing this population health approach, which I know you're familiar with, and I think is really critical because it leads into the budget items that I'll discuss, and I'll try to do this post-haste. So first of all, VDH represents the whole Commonwealth. We've got 119 local health departments organized into 35 health districts, each of the colored areas represents a different health district. Those are people, those are your constituents working in local health departments helping their neighbors. And this year is VDH's 110th anniversary, all started because of tuberculosis. So we have, I think, significant impact and a lot thanks to your support and your investment. We help with you keep, not only keep Virginians healthy, but we also keep the economic wheels turning. And I mention that because some things like supporting our shellfish sanitation program help make sure not only we're cleaning the Chesapeake Bay together, but we're keeping those industries sustainable and able to sell their products, not only in Virginia, but throughout the country. So I thank you for help there. In a graphic depiction here, I just wanted to emphasize that very quietly throughout the Commonwealth, those people that I mentioned are providing core public health services in communities. And probably, unfortunately, from a budget point of view, you don't hear about it when it's working well because they're evaluating diseases, doing investigations, continuing their surveillance, providing environmental health, working with public safety in response mode and preparing, and then all of the clinical services that you're probably more familiar with. So that's really an underpinning of what we do to help promote well-being and protect health throughout the Commonwealth, and I'm really thankful to all those people and thankful to you for your investment in doing them. I would hope that you would consider that as part of the critical infrastructure in communities, often unseen. It's something that we're considering now. And as you know, I've shown this slide before and I've updated the data, but we really do touch everyone's life from cradle to grave at some point, from vital records and newborn screening all the way through death investigations and everything in between. And this isn't a static process. We evolve what's needed based on what we hear and see about and evaluate in the community based on the data. And a good example of that, just over the past year, is a program we implemented because of the opioid crisis and the emergency declaration to make sure that naloxone was more readily available. That was over and above my standing order over a year ago now, but now our health departments are distributing naloxone to make sure that it's available to people who might not otherwise be able to afford it, because the standing order does not come with any financial support. So I'm kind of happy and unhappy to say that health departments in 9 months that we operated in 2017 have distributed over 14,000 doses of naloxone to multiple people, and I'd like to think that's had some impact on some of the data Dr. Carey showed you and more that I will show you in just a minute. So that's an example of how we've evolved our services to what's needed more acutely. I put this slide in here. This is actually flu surveillance data for Virginia. The top line is our youngest, 0 to 4 year olds. They have the most influenza-like illness in the Commonwealth now. This is pretty real data. It's trended over the course of the year with the most recent data on the right. We are not peaked yet, and you've heard of a lot of news about flu. I know we even had a member who was hospitalized for influenza just here recently, but it is a critical issue this year. We're worried about the severity, and I don't think we've seen the worst of it yet. So I bring this in for two reasons. One, I hope you've all been vaccinated, and you'll help encourage that, and that you have perhaps appropriate antivirals ready if needed. Because early treatment is critical too. But in addition, this is the surveillance that our folks are doing every day. Again, quietly, but importantly, and much of this actually is supported by federal dollars. I'm hoping the federal government is open now, but we're gonna continue our work in the meantime. And in addition, I wanted you to know, as I've said before, that most of the dollars that you give us go back to the communities, 88% in fact, and I think that's really critical because that public health service is our front line. We have used that funds to leverage other work, and some of that is our preparedness work. We're considered, Virginia's considered a national leader in public health preparedness, and that's because we've leveraged our general funds and we've utilize the federal funds that we've got to really produce, I think, very robust capabilities, not just in the public health department, but throughout the healthcare system. And in addition, we have tapped into the volunteer spirit in Virginia. We have almost 10,000 volunteers, a number of them medical personnel. And in 2016, when we last looked at it, we'll have 2017 figures, their volunteer work was valued at over $1 million. I have to say that some of those volunteers were in Charlottesville on August 12th during those events, and they frequently volunteer throughout the Commonwealth. In addition, we're the only state that all of our local health districts have met national criteria for public health preparedness in a project called Project Public Health Ready. So I just wanted you to know your investment has gone far, and we've leveraged that against some other critical investments in through federal dollars and others. Now, I'd like to talk about health status because we were making some progress, but we seem to have stagnated. When I was here last year, I showed you 2015 and 2016 health status rankings through America's Health Rankings. This is a national entity that benchmarks our outcomes in Virginia against others. In 2015, we ranked 21st of all the states, and then I showed you we had improved to 19th. Lower is better, but we have not changed. We're kind of plateauing, and I think that's worrisome, and I'll show you some more information about that. And I know last week you heard from my colleague Jack Barber at Department of Behavioral Health and Developmental Services. I was particularly moved because of a mental health report called 2018 Mental Health in America, and it ranked, you see we're here overall ranked 19th, but it ranked Virginia in terms of mental health outcomes 40th, 40th out of the 52 states. And what was even more concerning, because I think it bodes poorly on what to expect down the road, children's mental health, we ranked 47th. That's pretty telling. Now, we're stagnating, and there are probably lots of reasons for that. Senator Barker knows a lot of them, so he can go.
I got a pass.
I've shown you this slide in terms of the county health rankings. We've compared counties in terms of their outcomes. This happens to be outcomes for quality and length of life, two things that people really care about. And the more darkly shaded counties are lower ranked in terms of those outcomes than the lower, the less shaded areas. And you know, you could say, well, of course there are going to be some counties ranked higher than others. But what I always make as a critical point here is that in Virginia, our best ranked counties in terms of these outcomes are the best in the country, and our worst ranked are the worst in the country. So in an 8-hour drive, we've got the whole spectrum, and that should be telling in terms of the difference in opportunity for people to be healthy, which we've tried to capture on this next slide in a manner of identifying geographically where it's harder for people to be healthy, quite frankly. We looked at all those other determinants of health, things that I know you have looked at because you have supported housing for seriously mental ill, for example. So you know the value of trying to get to the root of the issues. And when we look at this geographically, it maps what we saw in terms of those health outcomes, that where it's harder for people to be healthy, their outcomes are going to be worse. So I hope you would continue to think about making investments on those root cause issues as you've done, because it says here in the slide that if we don't do that, we won't see the outcomes that we need. And I'll put in here too another piece of this, which is adverse childhood events, ACEs. You may have heard about a growing concern, and it's something we, for the first time in our Virginia Plan for Well-Being, have looked at in terms of adult reporting on adverse childhood experiences. And I was really literally blown away as the commissioner that when we first looked at that, 60% of adults in Virginia in our survey reported that they had an adverse childhood experience. 60% of adults. And that was looking back in life. So we've got some huge issues, and clearly attention to those things that cause adverse childhood experiences, like the opioid and addiction crisis, are really critical and need our attention. So I know Dr. Carey showed you one slide. This is another way. You've seen this slide, actually. The top line on the right is our addiction fatalities, drug overdose fatalities, which had taken that significant increase in 2016, about 40% increase. And then in 2017, beginning, I'll say, level off. It's actually hasn't leveled, but a lower rise in terms of the numbers of deaths. But you know, back in 2013, those deaths for the first time became the top cause of unintentional deaths, or deaths due to unintentional injury, over and above motor vehicle crashes. But I will report out that the lower line, which is the motor vehicle crashes, and the middle line, which are firearm-related deaths, are also both going up, and quite frankly, that could also be related to the addiction crisis that we're dealing with. So we've seen a leveling off or a decrease in the rate. I'd like to say perhaps the naloxone has helped, perhaps decreased prescribing of opioids has helped. All of those things are happening, but we've got a lot more work to do, and we're not out of the woods. So I think there's still an emergency. And then there's a whole nother population of people who are really unintended victims. Those are the newborns who are being born in withdrawal, basically, addicted to drugs. And this is the way it's looked since 1999. You can see the dramatic increase to the point now about 700 births a year or more are to women whose children are born addicted. This is huge. And this is also one of those critical things. That means those 700 children are born immediately with an adverse childhood experience, and that will impact their lives. Not to mention the human impact, but my partners at DMAS tell us that every one of these cases costs about $60,000, and a large percentage of them are paid for by the state through Medicaid. So you can see that the increase in the cost alone
you could argue that's almost $42 million with those cases, as opposed to in 1999 maybe $6 million. Those numbers are big either way, but a huge increase, and that's something I'd like you to consider how we might prevent, and I'll talk about it in a moment. The other thing that's impacting our outcomes is our infant mortality rate for the first time is going up. We had a long history of decreases, and with this, prematurity rates are going up, in all likelihood to some degree impacted by the opioid addiction crisis. And I think we really have to act, because otherwise you know the direction that things are going to go. All of us are trying to deal with these by taking a population health approach, which quite simply is a good look at the data, get all the data that we can, get the communities informed, get them acting, and be very intentional to work on those things that I mentioned that are underlying these issues. The Virginia Plan for Well-Being, which has been that action framework, has been endorsed by a number of communities, by a number of organizations, and I'm glad to say by my partner agencies, as a framework to help us align our efforts better. And I think it's been really invaluable. A pivotal part of that is assuring a strong start for all children. So we've got some work to do given the opioid crisis. In terms of the data, the health department has taken this literally. We're making as much of our data as we can available. If you go to our website, you'll see a banner not only about the opioid addiction, but the red circle is our data portal, which if you haven't visited, I would ask you to do. We've also created a website just for the General Assembly, so you can see data about your own communities, and I hope you'll look at that too. Tom Frieden, who is the former director of the CDC, put this out as a way of helping us align our efforts. Most of our time and effort and money goes to the top of the pyramid where we support individual care, which is important, but the providers know their outcomes just aren't going to be what they are expecting or intending unless we all work together to work at the bottom of the pyramid too, and that's where policy really makes a difference. So I look at this as an opportunity to align policy and support the clinical efforts that are going on, and I think a good example is what you did with housing for the mentally ill and other housing initiatives, which really get to a root issue, help wrap around services, and help some of the seriously ill get the care they need, but get all the other services so they even can get to care in the first place. So from the perspective of the strong start, these are some things that I've actually shared with you last year in terms of what I think we can do given what's going on in Virginia for the last couple of years. And I'll just mention the highlighted area. I talked to you last year at 2014 data. I said to you at that point, 34% of pregnancies in Virginia were non-marital. It's gone up. So that's gone up, prematurity's gone up, infant mortality's gone up, neonatal abstinence syndrome have all gone up. We have got some work to do in addition to having a more trauma-informed approach. I think to Dr. Carey's point with respect to prevention, so one of the budget items relates, as you heard, to promoting and increasing opportunities for long-acting reversible contraception, which I think is of interest to women in the Commonwealth, but the access is really the issue. And when we look at it in the health department, the breakdown on the left is updated information. I actually showed this slide to you last year in terms of who we see and their insurance status. So most of the people we see are not insured. And we believe that if you look at what's happened around the country with implementing better access to the best form of contraceptive, long-acting reversible contraception, we could see results at least as what you see here in terms of decreasing teen pregnancy, reduction in the unintended pregnancies, which as I mentioned are going up, and then something I think we all would support, which is decreasing abortions too. So I'll come back to that in the budget amendments, but that's the basis for this. I'd like to switch gears a little bit. I don't often talk about environmental health, but that's something that we do too, and it's part of our evolution moving forward to figure out what's the best use of state resources to protect the environment and to support what people need to do in their homes and in their communities. And I have to tell you on this slide, the flag that's circled is the proverbial first flush. So if you have a septic system, you know what I'm talking about. On the left in the blue is everything that needs to happen before you can take that first flush if you have a septic system. So yeah, it has to be designed and permitted, inspected, et cetera. That was the purview of the health department for many years, but then you gave authorization for the private sector to get more involved in that, and they have. And so we're in this situation where there's competition going on in some areas, and we would like the private sector to take more and more of that and let the health department step back and work on the right side after the first flush, which is also very critical and where homeowners and others have the biggest problems. They have to assure that their systems are up and running, maintained, and that they have educationally what they need to do that. And that's an area that we have not invested time and effort because most of our attention has been on the left side. We would like to move to a more quality control, quality assurance role, continue our partnership with the private sector, let them do what they can do on the left side, and let us do what the private sector can't do on the right side of that. So we have, and we've studied this over a number of years now with the stakeholders, and we have some legislative action going on this past year, and also this year. Delegate Orok has a few bills in to help with this transition. Last year, and we issued a report to the General Assembly on this whole process. We've already implemented the things that don't require legislation. This year, to keep moving, which I hope you'll let us do, it does require legislation and appropriate budget amendments. And the critical thing here is that we still need our staff to do this. But if we move to the right side, we'll lose the revenue we get with the current things that we're turning over to the private sector, as we should. But we need to maintain our staff to do the QA work. So I wanted to put that out there, and I'll come back to it with the budget amendment. And the last thing is something you also gave authority to the commissioner, which was to approve a cooperative agreement in Southwest Virginia, the tail of Virginia, if you will, and allow systems, healthcare systems, to merge if they so applied to do so, and if the Southwest Health Authority recommended approval to do so to the commissioner. Well, that indeed happened. The law went into effect. We got an application from Wellmont and Mountain States. Tennessee had to act similarly through their certificate of public advantage. And Tennessee approved that in September of 2017. I approved it on the Virginia side subsequently on October 30th. And then we also introduced measures to allow for the appropriate active supervision that are required by the law, and actually that the applicants need to continue to maintain antitrust protection, federal antitrust protection. The problem, quite frankly, was the initial legislation didn't consider what the actual cost of supervision would look like. And unfortunately for us, Tennessee's legislation did. And they have in their legislation opportunities to have reimbursement from the applicants to the state of Tennessee for that act of supervision, which is significant. So I put this up here because one of our budget amendments is authority to have that reimbursement from the applicants for that, for the costs of active supervision.
Listen, in that area, since you brought that up under this, because of that merger down there, I was going to have a question at the end relative to you have a whole lot of varied responsibilities, but in this arena, as far as monitoring the healthcare industry and COPN and all of those activities, do you have any thoughts on how we can do a better job of that? Seems to me you might be understaffed in order to really do a job that we're just not doing the job that we need to there.
I think the answer I can give you is a lot depends on what the legislative mandate is. In this case, I would say we're clearly understaffed in terms of the active supervision, which is why the budget amendment is in front of you. And I'll go through what I think there. Honestly, for the past number of years, there's been a lot of debate about COPN. So it all depends on what COPN looks like.
Right, but even as it exists now, I mean, you know, we have certain expectations of you, and I'm not sure that we're adequately staffed to deal with it.
As you know, when Secretary Hazel was here, there was a significant effort and a report put out, which I think laid out very explicitly what was required. So to that effect, you're correct. I don't think we've acted on any of those recommendations.
Okay. Thank you.
So I'll close with the budget pieces. And Again, I think you're pretty familiar with this, but the point I want to make on this slide is, if you look at the red part of the pie chart, that's our federal budget, which has grown over the years, makes up almost 50% of what we do. I was going to tell you what we're concerned about with closure, but I won't, because I believe that they'll be open, but let's just say we would be significantly impacted with the federal shutdown. The general fund is what it is there, and then we've got special revenues, I think many of you are familiar with. If you look at the trend, you've seen this chart, the top being the federal. That's going to come down some as some of the food programs move, the summer food programs, which I'll talk about. But this is the general shape of how we've managed over the years in terms of our funding sources. The actual introduced budget is in front of you here. I'll go into this in more detail in terms of what was introduced. And I'll start with something that you may or may not be aware of, but that's that the health department operates through a paper system of medical services. And I find it interesting when you've given us authority to move forward with amazing projects like the Emergency Department Care Coordination Project, which is underway, I'm happy to say, is going well, and I think will be a real asset to the Commonwealth. The problem is that the health department won't be able to connect to it because we have no capability. We have no electronic health record capability, so we put in front of you here a budget amendment to get us moving. And as you know, the health department is part of the safety net, so we think it's important.
Mr. Chair.
Yes, Senator.
So, Dr. Levin, is that money we can we use? Can we do a drawdown relationship with the federal government to fund that EMR? With the high tech dollars?
That's a good question. We actually have talked about that potential. We will look into it, but I can't tell you that we can do that right here now. And it depends, obviously, about what transpires with the ED care coordination.
You just tell us what you need to have transpire with the ED care coordination.
We'll work on that.
Okay, well, thank you. The next relates to two aspects of environmental health. The first is a data system upgrade. It's not a new system, it's just augmenting what we have so we can do the analytics that we need to move toward what I mentioned to you before. And this is what it would cost us to upgrade to a more sophisticated application that has that analytic capability. And I think we're poised to be able to utilize this, so I hope you will support that. The bottom piece is what I mentioned to you before. It's really allowing us the authority to begin to charge for things that weren't charged before, related to upgrades, repairs, and reviews, the work that the health department would do. And this is really critical because otherwise we would not be able to maintain our staff to do the work that I was talking about before. There's also one other environmental health one that really relates to our work with VDACs. Many of you know that we both inspect food facilities. We've divvied this up. We have a very active MOU, and we've had a good collaboration. This is budget language that asks us to continue to look at ways that we can enhance our collaboration, which we're happy to do. In our community health services realm, again, this is the local health departments. You heard from my colleague at Social Service about their rent increase. We have the same. So that's what's here in front of you, and ours is a cooperative budget. Anything we do with the state requires local matching dollars too. And then the bottom is the whole issue of the long-acting reversible contraception, because the idea is that those TANF dollars would go toward actually procuring the LARCs and then making them available to the women in the health departments. But there's also an educational and outreach piece, so people even know that they're available. And the money identified here was estimated based on what we believe the need would be to make a significant impact and to meet the demand from women who would likely seek out the LARCs. And I just have to say for the record, because I know there's been a lot of comment about LARCs, but it is the most effective of all the contraceptions. This use is consistent with what's recommended, and quite frankly, the way they work is they prevent fertilization. They do not impact implementation. They're not abortifacients. And that's right out of a report from the American College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists. And again, I think as commissioner, I have to sit here and say, with everything that's happened over this past year, particularly around opioids, I hope you would give the serious consideration this year, because it could really impact the whole issue with the neonatal abstinence.
Right.
And things have changed.
Versus that you've highlighted that, and we, this committee struggled with that last year, and Governor North and Lieutenant Governor at the time made a strong case personally, and we, as we sat at the table, we established other priorities for the town budget, but we'll be looking at it again.
I would ask you to do so, please. Thank you. In the licensure and certification is the cooperative agreement. We estimate, and we haven't done this before, but I believe this will be an upper limit estimation that it would require 6 individuals to do this work. You see the funds there, those are non-general because they would be sought for reimbursement from the applicants, and at least one, if not two, of those people would be based in Southwest Virginia. There's also, in our epidemiology realm, there are monies requested to get us started to be able to provide a dose of meningococcal conjugate vaccine for 6th grade entry, if the General Assembly agrees to add that to the required school entry vaccine, and that's what it would cost us to get it up and running. We have another arena that's actively evolving, and I'm sorry to say it's partly related to the opioid crisis too. The medical examiner has been incredibly busy with opioid deaths on top of everything else. And in addition, we're transitioning away from the what's called the local medical examiner model. We used to have physicians who would volunteer their time. It's just not a viable model anymore. So the 12 FTEs are partly for the forensic pathologists, the doctors who do the autopsies, but much of it is for medical investigators who would do a lot of the field work and deal with investigations for the deaths that we're seeing. We have other just real world issues in the middle. There is an attempt to increase the transport rate. And the bottom line is that funeral homes won't pick up bodies and transport them at $100, just not what it costs them. I can't even remember the last time we increased this, but it's been years. So this is an attempt to try to get this just at a rate that we could actually have people work for to do this. The lab has made it clear that in order for us to provide the standard of care of evaluation of an infant death, a sudden infant death, and the lab tests required to do that, this is what it would cost to keep this going. So we think that's a critical service. Fortunately, not a lot of cases, but enough that it's a significant request to put in. And then I'll just close by saying you approved the transfer of part of our summer feeding program and others. So this budget item is just to make that permanent. And then there's also in the introduced budget monies for the free and charitable clinics. Mr. Chair, members of the subcommittee, that is my report. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Okay. Thank you, Marissa. Members have any questions? A lot of information there.
Thank you.
So, okay, thank you very much. Appreciate it. Okay, Mike, does that complete our docket?
Yes, it does, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, any member have any questions or comments? Hearing none, we will rise.